Good evening. Either this pulpit has gotten taller or I've gotten shorter in the last week or two. It seems like my notes are up here somewhere. It's difficult. Glad to see you all here. I'm glad there is no snow falling, nor rain, which might turn to snow or anything else. There were some nastinesses in the forecast, but those did not materialize, so that's good. This is, as you know, the fifth installment in the Winter Lecture Series for 2017. I think it's been a productive, provocative, useful series, and you will not be disappointed tonight. The series, as you know, is co-sponsored by the Social Action Committee of the Unitarian Church, by Humanities Nebraska, and by the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute, OLLI. And our speaker tonight, Chuck Collins, is familiar with the OLLI programs in other parts of the world. Next week, we will wind up the series, and I want to encourage you to come back. We will have a panel discussion. The panelists will discuss a number of the issues related to inequality and how it impacts varieties of different people and strategies for dealing with problems arising from that. I think, will find the panel very useful, and it'll be particularly nice because none of us whom you've seen in front of you in the last 5 weeks will be involved in the panel, so it'll all be fresh eyes and fresh ideas, so welcome back. I also want to remind you that each of the lectures that we've had, each of the discussions that we've had, will be available on the Unitarian Church website, so that if you've missed one or want to go back and review one, you'll be able to do that shortly. Those will be available to you. As all of you know, the topic of this year's Winter Lecture Series is inequality of income and wealth. What you may not know is that if you type the word inequality into your web browser, after you get past the dictionary definition and a brief statement of its meaning in mathematics, you are likely to see a picture of this evening's speaker pop up, along with the website he co-edits, titled inequality.org. I would urge you to visit that website. It has wonderful resources, and it is constantly providing new information on the topic. Chuck Collins is a senior scholar at the Institute for Policy Studies in Washington, where he directs the program on inequality and the common good. He has been working to reduce inequality and strengthen community since 1982, when he was only 5 years old. And from that moral perspective, at age 26, he gave away the inheritance which was his due as the great-grandson of Oscar Mayer. He has been instrumental in founding initiatives such as the Wealth for the Common Good, United for a Fair Economy, Divest, Invest, and Patriotic Millionaires, among others. He has worked with Bill Gates Sr. on the politics of maintaining the estate tax and has been active in community development, particularly in his home community of Jamaica Plains, Massachusetts. And from reading his most recent book, I know that his local activism has even included pushing for sufficient staffing at the Curtis Hall Community Center to ensure that families could use the swimming pool during hot Boston summers. Chuck walks the walk. He doesn't just talk the talk. He holds a BA from Hampshire College. That's probably where all the trouble started. And a master's in community economic development from Southern New Hampshire University. He is author or co-author of several books about inequality, tax policy, and social change philanthropy. His most recent book, published last year, is Born on Third Base, A One Percenter Makes the Case for Tackling Inequality, Bringing Wealth Home, and Committing to the Common Good. Born on First Base was featured on the PBS NewsHour's Art Beat just 10 days ago, on March 3rd, as one of five books that, quote, will make you think about what it means to be human. I've just finished the book. I agree with that description. And I can tell you that a few copies will probably be available in the gallery for purchase by those of you who are lucky enough to get to the front of the line. As your Winter Lecture Series committee put together this series, we felt that you would have by now heard a lot of discouraging news in those first 4 weeks, and this might be a time to insert a little positive thinking into the discussion. A dedicated and vigorous change agent like Chuck Collins can do that. Chuck and his wife just yesterday finished several days of chaperoning their son's high school class on an educational trip in D.C., and he thought he'd spend a little rest and relaxation time by visiting us in Lincoln. We're delighted that you put us on your schedule, Chuck. Thank you. Welcome.
What Jerry neglected to say is he got me out of some snow shoveling duty in the next couple of days in Boston, so I'm really happy to be in a place where it's not, you know, a foot of snow is not coming. So, but it's true, if I look tired, it's because I've just spent, you know, the last 4 days with 120 high school students making sure they stayed in their own rooms. So you know what that's like. But I'm really happy to be here. I'm a native Michigan. I was born in Wisconsin. And the Oscar Mayer connection comes from my Wisconsin roots. I'm just curious how many of you were able to come to one of the previous programs. Okay, so most of you, yeah. I should say that I used to do a PowerPoint presentation that would have just brought you just in tears to your knees, you know, with data. But one thing I've learned in the last couple of years is that kind of explaining the context or the data is important, but that there are some powerful stories that hold these inequalities in place. How we think about it is actually one of the barriers to solving the problem. So I want to do a little more storytelling with you tonight. As well as talk, as Jerry promised, about sort of what are some of the things communities are doing to address these inequalities in this moment that we're in. But as Jerry said, you know, I grew up in the 1%. My great-grandfather was the meatpacker Oscar Mayer. My dad used to say, bringing home the bacon has a different meaning in our family. And yes, I have driven the Wienermobile, only in a parking lot, though. But I grew up in a suburb of Detroit, Bloomfield Hills, which is really kind of an affluent bubble. I did not really understand where I fit in because, you know, there was this guy, Mitt Romney, who was a couple years ahead of me, and his dad was the governor, and he lived in this giant house. And Kathy Iacocca, her dad, you may remember him. And then Bill Taubman, his father was the biggest shopping center developer, and he came to school in a chauffeur-driven car, and the chauffeur opened up the door. So I actually grew up thinking I was middle class because my dad drove us to school in his own Mercedes-Benz, you know. And if it wasn't for the fact that I also lived next to Detroit, where my dad worked and where, you know, we would kind of go back and forth and cross the sort of racial and economic divide, that really planted a seed that, you know, things are out of balance here. But I want to share a story, and it may seem like it goes on for a little bit, but I want to share a story about sort of how did I go from that to the work that I do now, looking at these inequalities. And when I was 26, my first real job out of college was I worked with mobile home park residents who lived in mobile home parks where they didn't own their land. And I worked with these tenants to buy the parks and own them as cooperatives. And it was a remarkable job. And one of the first mobile home parks I worked with was in this little town in western Massachusetts, Bernardston, Massachusetts. 30 mobile homes, so maybe 60 residents lived in this park. And it was really through them that I came to really understand what it felt like to be in that situation, which is your park is up for sale, the land is up for sale, and you're at risk. If that park sells, the landlord could boost the rent or just throw everyone out. And there was this vulnerability of knowing that, you know, if you had to move your so-called mobile home, it could be damaged and you could damage your one main asset. But what I'd really seen was that this was a community where people really had put in a lot, even though they didn't own the land or own the park, they had made investments. They had built porches and carports and a picnic area and planted gardens. And even more important, they had really formed a neighborhood. And all of that was at risk. One thing you should know, at the age of 26, I was really skinny and I looked like I was about 18. And I had terrible skin acne, which made me look even younger than I was. So imagine I'm meeting with the leaders of this park and they're looking at me thinking, this is the guy who's going to help us save our park, you know, this 20-year-old guy with the bad skin. But they were very trusting of me. And so one night I am in a double-wide mobile home owned by Harlan and Mary Parrott. Harlan is the retired shop steward of Greenfield Tap and Dye. He had worked his entire life. He was really the organizer. He had gotten everyone together. And I was meeting with 9 of the leaders from this park. And I was, to be honest, in agony for 2 reasons. One, I knew everybody's financial secrets because I had, in order to see if they could buy the park, I had interviewed each resident about what their savings were, what they could apply toward the purchase of a park, a down payment, what their monthly income was. I knew, like, all their IRS data, privately, confidentially. And I had found, in my assessment, that this group did not have the resources they needed to be able to pull it off. They were, you know, about a third of them had 0 or negative savings. A third were retirees who had very modest nest eggs, so it was not a wealthy group at all. And so I was going to have to break the news that they really had a gap of about $35,000 of what we believed they needed to have for a down payment, what I knew they needed to have. But the other reason I was in agony was I had a secret, which was I was from a wealthy family. Nobody there knew my circumstances. And I was in that moment thinking, $35,000. I could personally write a check and make this buyout possible. I could pretend it came from another place. Even I got a grant. Look at this, amazing, a miracle. And so I'm actually sitting there weighing that, because that $35,000 wasn't going to make a huge difference. At the age of 21, I had been given a trust fund that had actually doubled in 5 years in value. So I'm thinking, maybe I'm going to do this. Maybe I'm going to write this check. So I explained to the 9 leaders of the park who are sitting there, here's the situation. And there was a little pall in the room. And then this guy, Reggie, gets up and he says, you know, I have enough to purchase my share, and I have another $6,000 that I will put in toward the park's purchase. And of course, I'm the only person in the room that knows that that's all his money. And then another couple, the Dundorfs, say, well, we have enough to purchase our share, and we'll put another $7,500 in. And I'm like, that's all their money. And around the room they go. And it comes to Harlan and Mary, and Harlan says, we have enough to buy our share, and we'd also like to purchase Mrs. Revis's share on her behalf, on the understanding that she doesn't learn that we've done that in order to protect her privacy and her dignity. And I happen to know Miss Revis is one of the people who's really on the edge. If the rents go up at all, she's not going to be able to stay. And they are now a couple $1,000s close to closing the gap. And in come Harlan and Mary's daughter. She works at the bank. She has a good job. She says, I'll put in the rest. And they cheer. They've done it. They have raised the $35,000, drawing down pretty much everything that everybody has in the room. And at that moment, they literally pull out their checkbooks and start writing out their checks to me, because we don't have a bank account yet. So they're going to empty out all their bank accounts, hand me the checks to drive to the bank and open up our account for our down payment. And I was, you know, my hands were shaking as I left there to go to the bank. And here's the good news. They succeeded. They bought the park. And on the day of the closing, like 50 people crammed into this law office conference room to witness the signing. And all the men had cigars, like proud parents and grandparents. And they were kind of, and Harlan had told the Greenfield Recorder newspaper, we have been wandering in the desert, but we just bought the land from Pharaoh. We are hostage no more. That was the headline, hostage no more. And they were starting to get kind of light, you know, they were kind of like, what else can we buy, you know? The Pinecone Diner is up for sale. You know, they were getting excited about that. And Mary came up to me and she said, you're a smart young, you know, 20-year-old guy. I'm like, I'm 26, you know. But you're a smart young man, you know. You seem to understand a lot about finance, and you probably could get a job on Wall Street. I hear they're hiring. There's a lot going on there. You could. Why are you hanging around with a bunch of old fogies like us? That's literally what she said. I said, you know, I can't think of anywhere I'd rather be today. And then she sort of leaned over in a very maternal way, and she said, have you ever tried Noxzema? Said, yeah, I have. So they succeeded. But I had come very close to writing a check, and it had set in motion a process in my own mind, which was, first of all, I kind of wanted what these people had. I mean, I grew up in a wealthy community where people were generous, where people were charitable, but I had never seen people all in for each other, maybe call it solidarity, as I did on that day. And I wanted some of what they had. And I started to realize that this wealth that had been given to me was actually maybe a barrier. I thought of it very personally, like kind of a spiritual barrier to my being able to kind of have the relationships that I wanted. And so I started to think about, well, you know, I have a lot of advantages. Maybe I should just move this money along. And so I decided I was going to give away this inheritance I had. And so I wrote my parents a letter thanking them for the opportunities I'd had growing up and for being able to go to college. I literally could write checks out of my checking account to pay my college tuition, but that I wanted to pass the gift on. That there were other needs that I saw, and there were other mobile home parks that didn't have the capacity these folks did to pull it together. So I sent this letter off to my parents. A couple days later, my dad called. He said, you haven't given away the money yet, have you? I said, no, not yet. He said, well, I'd love to talk to you about it before you do that. So he actually came out from Michigan to Massachusetts, and like any kind of loving parent, he wanted to, you know, do due diligence, find out what I was thinking about. He actually later said he was greatly relieved that I just hadn't joined a cult. But he, you know, he asked me, so how did you get to this decision? And that was an invitation for me to talk about what I had been seeing in the work and in my life. And he said, well, you know, listen, you're young. You're 26 years old. And, you know, you've lived a sheltered life, to be honest. You've lived in a bubble. Bad things can happen. And, you know, what if you're single today, but what if someday you are married or have a partner and that person gets sick? Wouldn't you wish you had some of that money to fall back on? Or what if you have a child and that child has a special need? If you had that money, you would be able to not have to work. You could take care of your child, or, you know, it would be a cushion. He said, have you thought about that? I said, I have thought about it. I said, if that were to happen, I would be in the same boat as 99% of the people I know, and I would have to get some help. I would have to lean on my friends and people. And he said, well, in the end, if it's a big challenge, you would have to fall back on government. You'd have to fall back on this tattered, lousy safety net we have in this country. And I said, well, if I didn't have this money, maybe I would have an even more bigger stake in fixing that safety net so it worked better. And he's like, oy. So idealistic, right? Now, as you know, now I have children in their 20s, so this all comes back, you know. I'm like saying, look, your brains are still developing. In that moment, my father was kind of remarkable, and he said, you know, I think I understand. I just wanted to hear that you had thought it through, and no strings attached, you know, and I'm always going to be your dad, you know, so good luck. With that sort of blessing, I went to the National Bank of Detroit a couple months later and signed these papers, and I'm sitting in the trust office of the National Bank of Detroit, and my trust fund officer is an African-American woman named Glenda Allen, grew up in a working-class family in Detroit, had worked hard to get a really good job in this bank, and I still know her today. I still have a relationship with her, but she, at that moment, we didn't know each other that well, and she sort of looked at me. At one point, she's looking at me signing over, you know, this these stocks and funds to these foundations. She says, "Are you going to be all right?" I said, "I think so. I mean, everybody's kind of acting like I'm about to jump off a cliff, but I think I'm going to be okay." And I have to say, in that moment, I had no idea how much advantage I still had. I thought I would sort of move this inheritance along, and then I would just become, you know, Joe Worker, you know, or something. And I have this mountain of other advantage that was just kind of wired into my life. I mean, four generations of economic stability, of family social safety nets, of home ownership, of access to education, access to early intervention with, you know, among my family and friends, and over generations, people who could, you know, something bad happened, people could step in. I'm white, I'm male, I grew up, you know, I have a debt-free college education, which, as we know today, is a huge advantage. I have a sense of agency in the world that not everybody has, comes from sort of the privilege, et cetera. So I didn't understand that. I still am fully coming to grips with that. I don't have to take care of my parents. I don't have to worry about them economically. I still have to worry about them, but I don't have to, they fundamentally have safe, you know, resources. That's a huge advantage, right? So, but at that moment, I felt like I was taking a leap of faith. And a couple weeks later, you know, I went back to my job, and I'm working around New England with these mobile home parks. And I should say, one of the groups I work with last week completed the 120th resident mobile home buyout in the state of New Hampshire, which is tens of thousands of people who own the land, who now have the ability to make investments in their communities, knowing that they have the security of tenure to stay there. So I feel good about that work. But a couple months go by, and then something bad happens in my life, which is the house I'm living in burns down. No one is hurt, but I pretty much have lost everything. I mean, I've lost everything that I have, and including, you know, all my paperwork and, you know, bank accounts, and, you know, just, it's completely, if you've been in that situation, it's highly disorienting. And my housemate Greg and I are kind of standing in, the next morning, we're sort of standing there looking at this house of ours that, you know, thousands of gallons of water has been poured into it. And I look up and four cars pull up. And out of those cars come a dozen of these Bernardston Mobile Home Park tenants. And they have casseroles, trash bags, shovels, and they have come to help us put our lives back together again. And in that moment, I was like, I think I'm going to be okay. So I share that story because that was a turning point. But it also gives you think about this. I had this intimate front row seat. So in the 1980s, I mean, you've been going to several seminars now about economic inequality. So, you know, in the late 70s and 80s, we started to pull apart. Well, I was with, intimately working with, you know, thousands of mobile home park tenants doing the underwriting to see if they could buy their parks, where I got to know their, you know, what their savings were. I got to see how people were surviving as wages started to stagnate and fall. I saw how people took on more hours of work, how they went into debt, how they, the more people in their household were going into the workforce, how they were sort of scrapping, holding it together so that we could shoehorn them into buying these parks. So I had this personal front row seat to how stagnant wages was affecting people. But I also had this intimate front row seat into wealth multiplying, so that my family and friends and in the community in Bloomfield Hills, I would go back and people would say, yeah, we just, the house, we bought it for 10 and now it's worth 300,000 and we sold it, and, you know, our portfolios are now tripled in value, and, oh my God, I bought that share of Berkshire Hathaway, and look at that. You know, I mean, people were talking about wealth multiplying. So when people talked about, you know, the 1% is getting this amount of wealth and this, and I was like, yeah, I know those stories. I know those people. I have faces. So that, for me, made these inequalities very, very personal. And maybe the only, one of the things that I feel like I benefited from that decision to give away this inheritance was that it just allowed me to unflinchingly, without inner conflict, just look at what was happening in the society around me. So really over the 80s and 90s, doing this work, I saw how these inequalities were affecting people. So let's look at the current picture today. And I won't belabor this because this has been the subject of several other lectures, but in December, the three French economists, Thomas Piketty, Emmanuel Saiz, Gabriel Zucman, one of them is gonna win a Nobel Prize any minute now. They just did a study that looked at the last 40 years in the United States. The size of the economy has doubled, productivity has doubled, and the real wages of the bottom half of income earners has stayed flat. I mean, it went up like $4 a year, So half the population did not share in this enormous expansion of the economy. Since the economic meltdown, 85% of income and wealth gains have gone not just to the top 1%, but to the top 1/10 of 1%. The higher up the economic ladder we go, the more concentrated the wealth is becoming. The richest 400 households have as much wealth as the bottom 62% of the population. The richest 100, here's the one statistic I want you to put under your pillow tonight and just think about. The richest 100 billionaires in this country today have as much wealth as the entire African American population combined, 14 million households. And at the very, very top, the top 20, enough that could fit in a Gulfstream luxury 650 jet, 20 people have as much wealth as the bottom half of households. And that is in part because the number of households with zero or negative wealth has been steadily climbing. We're closing in on 20% of households, zero or negative wealth. Nothing to fall back on. So that's the picture. And I think the other programs you've been part of have talked about, why does this matter? I mean, there is now an interdisciplinary body of work in the last decade that, whether it's social science, political science, sociology, health, public health, showing these inequalities matter. They actually undermine pretty much everything we care about. So if you think about what is it we care about, well, we care about our children and their opportunity. Well, this is undermining social mobility. We care about our health. Well, too much inequality undermines, leads to a breakdown of social solidarity and a decline in public health. The more unequal a community, the worse its health outcomes are. It undermines economic stability. Many people say, oh, I'm concerned about, these inequalities. If we try to fix them, it might undermine the health of the economy. Well, guess what? These inequalities are actually undermining the health of the economy. If you care about healthy free market capitalism, if you care about economic stability and healthy growth, these inequalities add to volatility. They create more booms and busts. They create declines in aggregate demand, spending power by low and middle income households. So these inequalities actually undermine the most precious things: sports, culture, democracy, obviously. And I would even argue that this election that we're living, that we just lived through, and the results and the moment that we're in politically, is a function of inequality. A polarized economy gives rise to a polarized politics. When half the population does not share in the economic gains of the last generations, there's a huge well-up of betrayal and anger. And that well-up in anger expresses itself in a sort of populism. There's both the progressive populism of a Bernie Sanders that says the concentration of wealth and power, a few thousand corporations, the billionaires are rigging the rules of the economy, but it also gives rise to a regressive populism, a politics of scapegoating and blaming. Let's blame Mexicans and new immigrants and Muslims for the economic distress we're in. Those people are cutting in line in front of you. That's And so both of those things, but the, in a way, an interesting good news in that is that this is a response to these inequalities, and that there's a realignment happening politically that is a function of our society's inability to respond to those inequalities. And it could go either way, right? It could go progressive populist or regressive populist. It's really in our hands. It's up to us which way it goes. But, and this is historical. You know, 100 years ago, the last time when we had these extreme levels of inequality, the first Gilded Age, you know, 1890 to 1910 or so, also gave rise to progressive populism, of which we in, you know, Nebraska and the Plain States have a rich tradition, prairie fire populism that gave rise to antitrust legislation, the first income tax, the first tax on inherited wealth, direct election of U.S. senators, end of child labor laws. That was the progressive populist agenda that largely won out in the day. But there was also a parallel rise in regressive populism. The rise of the Klan, the rise of anti-immigration, the rise of nativism also accompanied in that period. You know, as I was with my 120 Boston Latin School students, we got to go to the African American History Museum, the Holocaust Museum. That's what I've been doing for fun the last couple of days. But, you know, one of the exhibits was about the rise of the Klan. You know, 1925, you know, 50,000 Klansmen and women marching in Washington. Part of this rise in both regressive and progressive populism. So these inequalities matter enormously. And one additional challenge is that's the picture today. Just one other sort of piece of the picture is, where are we going? Where, if we stay on the current trajectory, where is it that we end up? And this is where the French economist Thomas Piketty, some of you may have seen his book, Capital in the 21st Century. Some of you may own it. Fewer of you may even have read it. I'm happy to tell you there's a new book called The Pocket Piketty, which is literally, it fits in your pocket. It's a good distillation, and it kind of might inspire you to take another run at the main text. But, you know, one of his insights is, if we don't intervene in the current machinery of inequalities, if you will, that we are moving toward a society that will have a hereditary aristocracy of wealth and power, where the sons and daughters of today's billionaires will dominate our politics, our economy, our culture, and philanthropy. I think we have to wait another generation for this. It looks like it's happening, but that's where we're heading if we don't intervene in this system, if we just let things continue as they are on autopilot. If you look at this through a racial lens, the racial wealth divide, which today is still dizzying. I mean, the median white household has 13 times more wealth than the median African-American household, 10 times more wealth than the median Latino household. But if we play out the last 30 years into the next 30 years, the racial wealth divide will double. So by 2043, we will be a racial and economic apartheid society. And part of the reason I wrote this book, Born on Third Base, and I'm actually coming out, going and talking not just to anyone who will listen, thank you, tomorrow I'm going to Silicon Valley and I'm going to be meeting with the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, you know, the Facebook community, and I'm talking to this law firm of intellectual property, 200 intellectual property attorneys. The reason I'm talking to people in the 1% or the top 5% is to say, look, this is not these inequalities are bad for everyone, including the people at the very top, that this will actually undermine wealth. This will undermine health. This will backfire, and it is in your self-interest, not out of altruism, not out of charity, but out of your own deep self-interest, not to intervene, to not allow these inequalities to go the way they are. And that for people who have a lot of wealth and power and clout, I'm trying to make the case, step up. You know, if you put an ecological overlay on that, What I like to say is, look, there is no wealth on a degraded earth. There is no wealth without fresh water. So again, you have to step up everything you have to intervene and reverse these inequalities. So what is it that we can do, though? What are some of the things that together we can do? And one, I would just say there's two examples that we should look to. One is, we actually got out of the first Gilded Age. It wasn't just a depression and a world war. There were social movements that actually were critical to changing the distribution of income and wealth. I mentioned the populist movement, 1916, 100 years ago, the first income tax, the inheritance tax, that actually had an impact on slowing the concentration of wealth and power. So that after World War II, we did have 30 years of relative shared prosperity, where the rising tide really did mostly lift all boats. And we had this huge expansion of the middle class, primarily the white middle class, but we learned something from that. We know what we did. And the other example I would look to are the Nordic countries and Canada right now. If you want the American dream and you're not born in the top fifth, you're better off moving to Canada or to one of the Nordic countries, where they actually invest in public investments in creating opportunity and social mobility. Social mobility is declining in the US and rising in the countries that we used to think of as the old caste societies. So we can look and learn from those experiences. And there's three types of public policies that reduce inequality. One is the policies that raise the floor. And in the Nordic countries, they have a very high social floor. There's, through which you cannot fall. I mean, bad things happen to people, but there's a social safety net. And there are level playing field is the other type. You know, things that create opportunities, debt-free college education, access to health care, universal health care, paid parental leave, things that actually creates security and opportunity for people who are not wealthy. So lift the floor, level the playing field. Obviously, there are things we need to do to address the influence of money in our democracy, the way that's, And then we have to address the third type of problem, which is this concentration of wealth and power. And in some ways, that's the most controversial. Many people will get behind, let's raise the floor, or let's have a level playing field. But what I would argue is, right now, anything we do to raise the floor and level the playing field will be upended by the power of concentrated wealth in our society. That concentrated wealth is a form of political power, and that power is being used to shape and distort the rules of the economy. And until we address that, that's fine and well for me to say that standing here, but in this current political environment, it doesn't look like that's going to happen anytime soon. And in fact, a lot of the proposals will probably worsen the concentration of wealth and power. So what possibilities do we have? I would argue that this is a really important time to incubate local and state policies that reduce inequality. One thing you should know is reducing inequality is politically widely popular. 75-80% of the population believes we should raise the wage floor. Same percentage believes that wealthy people should pay more taxes, including the wealthy themselves. They'd like to know that those taxes are being invested in public goods that we believe in. But there's a base for these policies. Washington State just instituted its state-level inheritance tax, directing the revenue to something called the Education Legacy Trust Fund, which provides debt-free education to students in the state university system in Washington State. The anti-tax people put that on the ballot to repeal it. 62% of Washington State voters went to the polls to vote to keep it. That's an interesting dilemma, because Washington State is a very conservative state. It has no income tax. It's an anti-tax state. But here they defended a tax on inherited wealth because it was dedicated to something people understood. I think one of the biggest, and this is now being replicated in other states, Michigan, California, Maine, are all looking at how do you link taxes that actually put a brake on concentrations of wealth to something that clearly creates opportunity for lots of other people. Bill Gates' dad, Bill Gates Sr., who I worked with a lot, was a big champion of the idea of, he called it the GI Bill for the next generation. Let's, any young person who wants to do 2 years of national service, military or civilian national service, should get a debt-free college education funded from a trust fund with a tax on inherited wealth and billionaires. Direct that, you know, so that we not only reduce the concentration of wealth and power, but we invest it in such a way that creates opportunity, just as we did after World War II, and we reweave the social fabric as young people from different communities interact and have an experience of solidarity as a society. So those are some of the ideas that are being incubated. Many municipalities are looking at, how do we increase early childhood education? Are there things that we can do in terms of revenue at the local level? A couple of cities have introduced a city ordinance, a surcharge on companies that have, where the CEO pay is more than 100 times the average worker pay in the company. Portland, Oregon, and a couple other cities, and lots of number of states and other states and cities are looking at these CEO pay gap penalties. You know, your company wants to pay CEO more than 100 times, more than 250 times, you pay an additional business tax to do business in that city. Not just being based there, but doing business in that city. So lots of cities are looking at that. And I mentioned, Jerry mentioned inequality.org, but at some point I'll send around a clipboard. But if you're interested, I send out a weekly newsletter of what are all the things that people are doing to address these inequalities, what are the stories of campaigns and efforts at the local level. We kind of lift up heroes, try to have a sense of humor, et cetera. So I mentioned that. But as I mentioned at the beginning, we have work to do in terms of these campaigns, these policies, but there are powerful stories that hold these inequalities in place. I don't know if you've had this experience, but when you know, the data that I mentioned to you, some people feel galvanized by that, motivated by it. But other people sort of say, that's not that troubling to me because, those folks deserve it. The oil billionaire J. Paul Getty was once asked, how do you become wealthy in America? And he said, it's actually quite simple. And he said, there's three things you have to do. We'll do a little poll here. First, get up early every morning. How many of you got up early this morning? Okay, I know it was the Sabbath, but how many people will get up early tomorrow? Okay, good. Two, work hard all day. Okay, I know some retirees in the room. That's all right. Number three, find oil. Okay, well, some people see these inequality statistics and they say, well, some people get up early in the morning. Some people work hard all day. Some people, deserve and take risks and deserve what they get. And the inverse of that is that if you don't have that kind of wealth, then there's something deficient in you. That's a powerful story. I call it the story of deservedness or the myth of deservedness, which is basically people are where they are because they deserve to be there, simply put. Now, that's a powerful story. And all the data in the world isn't going to dislodge that story. And even though we're living in a time with deep structural inequalities that are kind of almost delinked from individual effort and merit, I mean, the last 15 years, most of the growth in income and assets is a function of return on capital, return on investment capital, nothing to do with wages and earnings. But yet people take this simple story of Jerry worked hard and Tom didn't, and project that onto these structural inequalities. How do you dislodge that? How do you change that story? Well, here's a clue that I got. And it came from, organizing to defend the estate tax. And I stumbled across 1,500 multimillionaires and billionaires who publicly said that they would spoke out to defend the estate tax, including Bill Gates' dad and Warren Buffett and a whole bunch of people. But we had this press conference one day, and there was a man you'd never heard of named Martin Rothenberg. And he was speaking at the press conference about why he It was somebody who would pay the estate tax, but felt it was fair. And here's what he did. He got up at this press conference. He says, you know, my name is Martin Rothenberg. I'm a software entrepreneur. I have such a substantial amount of wealth that I will someday pay an inheritance tax, this estate tax, or what some call the death tax. And he said, but I don't have a problem with that. Let me tell you why. And Martin says, I grew up in a low-income neighborhood. My parents had no money. They worked all the time. They never took a vacation my entire childhood. But I went to a really good elementary school. And I went to a great high school. And I had this amazing science teacher. And I went to this library that I could walk to or ride my bike to that was open in the evenings and on the weekends. And there was a librarian there who took a personal interest in me. Every time he came in, Martin said, this librarian would say, Martin, I have a book for you. And it would be a book about a biography of a scientist or a book of experiments he could do in his apartment without burning it down. He says, my family had no money, but I got a great education. Someone else paid for my education. And then I went to college and I got a complete free ride. Someone else paid for me to go to college. And then I went into this whole emerging sector of computer science where, I was largely built through public investments and research grants, and I started a company. And where did I hire my employees? I went down the road to the computer science department over here at the University of Nebraska. I talked to Sherrod and I said, send me your best students. Somebody else paid to train my workers, Martin says, in the platform of knowledge that my company required. And then a foreign corporation stole my intellectual property, literally stole my patents, and was going to put me out of business. The United States government went to the world court, defended my intellectual property, and won. He said, I didn't even know there was this whole apparatus to defend my property rights. Someone else paid to create that and maintain it for generations. So Martin looks out at this press conference audience. He says, so last year I sold my company for $30 million, and I have a couple other companies that are worth the same amount. If you abolish the estate tax, what you're essentially saying is I don't have any responsibility to pay back the society that made it almost entirely possible for me to get where I was going. He says, actually, and this is where he started pounding the table, he says, I have a moral obligation to pay back so that some other kid out there who's not born rich can have the same opportunities I had. Because what good societies do is they recognize if you have $10 million or $20 million or $50 million or $1 billion, you didn't do it alone. And that you have an obligation to pay back the society that created the fertile ground and the investments and the possibility for you. I remember he stopped speaking and everybody was speechless. I said, well, how often do you hear a story like that? Well, the good news is I hear these stories all the time because I'm helping organize wealthy individuals, people who are entrepreneurs, to talk about why we should maintain these investments in education and in society. What I love about their stories is they don't take away from the individual. The individuals matter. What individuals do, whether you get up in the morning and work hard, does matter. But what he's also, we understand the story of the individual in our culture, but we don't see or tell the story of the commonwealth, the web of what makes all that possible. And so what these people are doing is telling the story of individual success in the context of the web that we create together. And I think that's powerful. So in my work, in this book, Born on Third Base, I've been saying to the people like who grow up in my circumstances or people from the 1%, it's time to come home. Bring the wealth home. Bring the capital home out of the offshore tax havens, out of the global casino. Bring it back to local places. Invest in the real economy of goods and services. Invest in building resilient, healthy communities, supporting the next generation of businesses. Tell true stories of how advantage works. Share the wealth, but pay our fair share of taxes, because philanthropy is not a substitute for an adequately funded public system. And so that's the message I'm out there. But my message to everyone else is, it's time to get organized. You know, we have to come together to work to stop the bad, stop some of the regressive policies that are going to come at us that will worsen inequality, but also work in our communities where we have some sense of agency, where we can do things. And in the process of that, don't forget that there are potential allies among the wealthy, among the one percenters, if you will. There's a definite section of the 1% who use their wealth and power to get more wealth and power. But there's also a lot of people behind the scenes often working in the other way. And there's a lot of other people waiting to be engaged and invited home, invited back to the table. And I can attest, you know, I'm in touch with those folks. They're trying to find their way to the community projects and the efforts that you're part of. So I think we need to work and organize to change the rules, but we also have to change the stories. And I want to close with one other story, which is another piece of the equation, I think. I was speaking at a very wealthy congregation in suburban Los Angeles, and I was talking about the inequality moment we're in. And I said something like also that, you know, there are corporations now like Boeing and General Electric that pay their CEOs more than they pay in taxes. And at the end of the program, I'm talking to some individuals, and there's a tall, elderly gentleman waiting to talk to me. And it's just he and I talking, and he says, my name is Hank, and I'm actually the retired number three guy at the Boeing Corporation. I'm thinking, oh, well, this is going to be interesting. And he said, you know, I'm embarrassed that our company took so much from the taxpayers of America and paid back so little in taxes for the infrastructure we enjoy. But that's not why I want to talk to you. He says, I have a question for you, but I have to give you a little context, which is, since I retired a couple years ago, I have been working with my church on these mission trips. And I'm an engineer by training. And so I've been going to these rural African communities and helping build these kind of small-scale water treatment facilities. And it's completely a blast. And he says, a couple years ago, I was in Kenya, and I'm working on this project with a local village. And there are at least 6 or 7 children who every afternoon come and sit under a shade tree and just watch us like we're the best thing, best entertainment in town. And so I get to know these kids. And one day I said to them, where do you live? And they said, Uncle Hank, let us show you. And they lead him through this path, and they go over a little bridge, and they come to this kind of large, sagging, one-story building about the size of this room, kind of a wooden structure with a sagging porch, and it says orphanage on the side. And Hank says, oh, this is where you live. And they said, yeah, would you like to meet our adults? And he said, sure. And he got a little tour. And so he says he goes back, gets in his van, and goes back to his first world hotel, and he lay awake all night thinking about these kids. And the next day he goes back, and they're still there. And at the end of his trip, he goes to the orphanage, he talks to the adults, and he says, is there anything I can do to help? And the director of the orphanage says, well, we're only able to help about a third of the children that need our help. And Hank's like, well, what happens to the other children? And the director says, well, sir, you don't really want to know. He says, well, try me. He says, well, they often have to go into the cities, and we don't know what happens. Some of them are sold into slavery. He says, oh. He says, sir, we could use more buildings, as you could see, and our building is very tired. So Hank goes back to L.A. He goes back to his suburban congregation. He is a man on fire. He organizes 3 delegations. They go and build 3 new buildings. He raises money. They adopt this village and this orphanage as a congregation. And he says, you know, I worked at Boeing for 35 years. I worked with great people, high integrity, the kind of people you'd want on your team to solve any problem. I can't remember a day when we talked about poverty or what we were going to do about the inequalities around us. He says, now I see it everywhere I go. I came back from Kenya, all of a sudden, I see the issues in LA. I see the food system. I see the structural inequalities. I've gotten involved in projects in the city. He says, the other day, my wife said to me, Hank, you are reminding me a heck of a lot of the guy I fell in love with 45 years ago. His kids say, Dad, you seem like you're younger. You have some kind of spark. So he says, my question is, I'm like crying, you know, like, oh, he has a question, right. So my question is it too late for me, for us, to make a difference? I said, no, I don't think so. I think you're doing great. I said, Hank, we could probably use a few more like you, though. He says, oh, I'm working on that. I take my former engineering guys. We go to Africa. We have to go to Africa. Here's why we have to go to Kenya. Because these kids crack open people's hearts. Because there's no story that can justify the gap between their life and our lives that makes sense. And so therefore, I bring them over, they're all guys, a lot of them, they're ambushed. These children worm their way in their hearts. Then they come back to Los Angeles. Then I can introduce them. But if I just took them to downtown LA, they'd be like, oh yeah, we understand this problem, and here's the theory of why these people are poor, and da, da, da. He says, sorry, they're defenseless when I take them over there. Their hearts are cracked open, and then they get engaged in this way. I said, well, that's a good program, Hank. So I share that because my experience, my personal lived experience is we have to do this organizing work. We have to tell these true stories. But there's also this work of the heart. We have to crack open these hearts. And in that process, what we learn is we have a remarkable capacity to change how we think and how we act. We can respond to very different stories and stimulus, but it is through the stories and the changes in the heart that work happens. So that's the good news, is it's not too late. Thank you.
Usual format, we'll take a break for 10 or 15 minutes, have a cup of coffee, glass of water, a refreshment, and if you found anything that you might like to discuss with John.